Good afternoon. So in the last lecture we have discussed about domination, that is when we can say a solution is dominating another solution. So basically we are discussing about MOOPs, multi-objective optimization problem. So we'll continue our discussion. So today, in today's session, basically we'll be discussing the different types of MoEA algorithms that are available to solve MOOPs problem. So MOOPs stands for multi-objective optimization problem. So to solve those problems, there are many evolutionary algorithms available, and the different types of evolutionary algorithms that are available, we'll be having a brief look. Yeah, I'm sharing right now. Not it. Is it okay now? So basically we'll be discussing the various MoEA algorithms. We'll be discussing the algorithms, we'll not get into the problem, how it works. Okay, that's what we are going to discuss in today's session. So these algorithms are called as the algorithms which are used to solve MOOPs problem are called as multi-objective evolutionary algorithms. So EA stands for evolutionary algorithms. So basically these are algorithms which are based on genetic algorithm, right? The set of genetic algorithm techniques which are used to solve MOOPs problem are called as MoEA. Okay, so the various genetic algorithm approaches that we follow to solve a MOOP problem is called as MoEA, right? Generally there are two terms. One is called as GA. So GA stands for genetic algorithm, and the next one is MoEA. MoEA is multi-objective evolutionary algorithms. So whenever we say GA, actually we are talking about only single objective problem. The term GA is used to refer to single objective problem that are solved by using basic genetic algorithm techniques. So the term genetic algorithm just refers to single objective optimization problems that can be solved by using basic genetic algorithm techniques. Whereas the term MoEA, it refers to multi-objective problems. These multi-objective problems also, again, it will be solved by genetic algorithm techniques only. But the genetic algorithm techniques that are used to solve these multi-objective problems are categorized as EA. So EA stands for evolutionary algorithms. So basically these are also one type of genetic algorithms. You can say this is advanced genetic algorithm techniques, but these algorithms are used to solve multi-objective problems. Okay, I think it's clear. I will repeat. So we'll be using two terms throughout this course or in the lectures. So whenever you refer the term GA, what you should understand in this sense. So whenever we say GA, actually we are talking about single objective problems which can be solved by using basic GA techniques. Okay, but whenever we say MoEA, actually we are referring to multi-objective problems. The name itself, there is multi-objective problem, and here EA represents evolutionary algorithms. This is also one type of genetic algorithm techniques, but the genetic algorithm technique that were used to solve multi-objective problems are called as evolutionary algorithms. Okay, so with this intro, let us get into it. So that's what we are discussing in this particular slide. To distinguish GA to solve, so GA is used to solve single objective optimization problem. To that of MOOPs, a new terminology called evolutionary algorithm has been coined. Okay, so whenever you say GA, so GA is connected with single objective optimization, whereas whenever we say MOOPs, it is connected with evolutionary algorithms. But these evolution algorithms, it's the, they are also a class of genetic algorithm techniques. Okay. So mostly the genetic algorithm techniques that were used to solve MOOC's problem are called as MOEA in the literature, in the scientific literature, multi-objective evolutionary algorithm. Okay. And this is the MOEA framework. So the MOEA framework is very similar to genetic algorithm framework. Where it differs in the sense, it differs in selection strategy. And also it differs in fitness evaluation. But reproduction, all those things are same. Where it differs in selection and it differs in fitness evaluation. Okay. Why it differs in selection and fitness evaluation alone? If you ask that question, because in a single objective optimization problem, we have only one objective. So based on that objective only, we will select the individuals for mating. Whereas in case of multi-objective optimization problem, in case of MOEA, we have multiple objectives. So you have to look into more than one objective to perform selection. So obviously there is a difference in selection when you compare single objective problem or GA technique and MOEA technique. Okay. So this is the framework for MOEA. With respect to this diagram, it is quite similar. But the difference lies in the selection part. How selection is done. There, MOEA is quite different from GA. So the input is a MOOC problem which contains multiple objectives. Initial population will be generated. From that, we'll select some population based on fitness, and then we perform some reproduction techniques. Okay, and we see whether it is converged or not. If it is not converged, again select some other population and go for reproduction, and repeat this process until converged. So if it is converged, then return the solution. So this is the generic GA framework. The same framework is applicable for MOEA, with only exception that the style of selection will be different. Okay. So could someone summarize how GA differs from MOEA? What is GA and what is MOEA? Okay, what is EA represents? So they are used for what? They come under which category? So they come under genetic algorithm, but the evolutionary algorithms or the genetic algorithm techniques which are used to solve multi-objective optimization problems. Okay. So generally when we say GA, it refers to the set of GA techniques which are used to solve single objective problems. When you say MOEA, it refers to set of GA techniques which is used to solve multi-objective problems. So the basic difference between GA and MOEA lies in the input. So in case of GA, the input is a single objective function, single objective, okay? Whereas in MOEA, the input will be multi-objective, and also the difference lies in the output. In case of GA, the output will be a single solution, whereas in MOEA, the output will be a trade-off. What is a trade-off? Trade-off is otherwise called as Pareto optimal solution. So in GA, there is only single objective as input, whereas in MOEA, multiple objective input. In GA, the output will be a single solution, whereas in MOEA, the output will be a trade-off solution, that is a Pareto optimal solution. So what is a Pareto optimal solution? Could someone recall? What is a Pareto optimal solution?
D still the solution is cannot be improved by degrading or without degrading. Without degrading, yeah. The solution which cannot be improved without degrading some of the other objective functions. Such a solution is called as Pareto optimal solution. So MoEA, the output will be a Pareto optimal solution. Pareto optimal solution is otherwise called as trade-off solution. Trade-off means when you increase one thing, some other thing will decrease. Okay, so that is called as trade-off. Whereas in GA, there is only one output. Okay. So there are two major problems, or you can say design issues. So whenever we go for new technique, there will be some challenges. So what are the challenges with respect to MoEA when compared with GA? So the challenge is, the first challenge is how to perform fitness evaluation. Because in case of single objective optimization problem, or in case of the basic GA version, there is only one fitness score. So based on that, you can say that whether the solution is fit or not. But here you have multiple objective functions. So how are you going to evaluate the fitness? So how will you say that this solution is better than this solution? Okay. Say for example, the student is assessed based on several parameters, like how much marks he scores. That is one parameter. Okay. How much marks he scores, there is one parameter. Say how good he is in sports, there is another parameter. Say how good he is in social environment. Say a company is assessing on these three parameters to give the job. And they consider everything as equal importance. It is not that they are going to give more weightage for marks, nothing like that. Say they give equal weightage for everything. Okay. Now assume that the student is very good in marks. Say he got more than 90% in all. Okay. But say in sports he is very poor. He is 10%. Okay. And say in social activities he is quite okay, 60%. Okay. Now you cannot say this as optimal, right? You cannot say this as optimal. So when multiple parameters comes in, how are you going to judge the optimality? The question totally changes. Okay. If there is only one parameter, only marks is there, then only you can see this. So based on this you can say whether the fitness value is high or not. Okay. So this type of issues we will face. Because one parameter he may be excellent, or that particular solution may be excellent in one parameter, but in another parameter it may be very much less. Then how are you going to give some fitness score for that? Okay. And based on that, after giving the fitness score for every solution, based on that only we are going to perform selection. Selection is based on fitness score. Selecting the correct individuals for mating, that is based on fitness score, right? So how to accomplish fitness evaluation and selection in order to guide the search towards the Pareto optimal set? So this is one of the challenge. Okay, how to tackle this problem? Second problem is how to maintain a diverse population in order to prevent premature convergence and achieve a well distributed Pareto optimal front. So this means that the solution should not converge prematurely. So if the solution converges prematurely, it may not be an optimal solution. It may land into local optimal. So the population should be diverse so that you can explore different regions of the solution set. So that it is highly likely that we may move towards the global optimal. Okay. So how to ensure that there is a population diversity, and also how to ensure that the solution does not converge prematurely. Okay, so these are the two design issues with respect to MoEA, multi-objective evaluation algorithm. So basically, the multi-objective evaluation techniques are broadly classified under two categories. One is called as a priori approach, the other one is called as a posteriori approach. This previously also we have discussed. but now we will be discussing the various algorithms under this, right? So the various MoE techniques are classified under two categories. One is a priori approach, the other one is a posteriori approach. So in case of a priori approach, again we have two categories based on aggregation ordering and aggregation scalarization. So ordering, in the sense, it is something like there are, so in all these cases you have multiple objective function, f1, f2, f3 up to fn. So ordering, in the sense, we are going to order the different objective functions like based on their importance. So these are the objective function. Maybe out of that f5, if you consider f5 as the, should be given more important, than that will be first, then F7, like that. Is there any particular order which you feel, or based on some expert's advice, you understand that this order should be followed so that to get the optimal output? Okay, so basically this class of algorithm, this aggregation type of algorithm, it will try to order this objective function in a particular order so that it will give an optimal solution. So one example for this category is called as lexicographic ordering. Similarly, in case of aggregation, which is also called as scalarization, in this aggregation thing, what we do, in the sense, we assign some weight for each of the objective function, and we convert the multi-objective problem into a single objective problem. So we assign some weight, like W1 for F1, by W2 for F2, W3 for F3, like that, so on and so forth. We assign some weight and then we add all these things, okay, and we, by that process, we convert this multi-objective problem to a single objective problem. Now the question is, how are you going to assign this weight? Okay, so there are different ways of assigning these weights. So based on that, there are many algorithms like linear fitness evaluation, non-linear fitness evaluation, goal attainment, weighted min-max method, game theory. Okay, we'll not be discussing all these things in detail. We'll be, from this a priori approach, we'll be discussing two algorithms, only algorithms, how it works. This lexicographic ordering one we'll be discussing, and from this aggregation technique, we'll be discussing one. Okay. Similarly, coming to posteriori approach, there are multiple categories. So there is independent sampling, hybrid selection, criteria selection, which is also called as VEGA, VEGA. And again, out of this posteriori approach, these three are non-Pareto-based approach. Okay. Whereas these are Pareto approach, ranking and niching, deans and elitist. These are Pareto based approach. That is, these four algorithms, it will give a Pareto optimal solution. So Pareto optimal solution means it will give a Pareto friend. That is, you can consider any one of the solution in a Pareto friend, a particular line or a curve or whatever it may be. Okay. So all the solutions are of equal importance. So they don't dominate each other. So that's what we have discussed in the last class. The set of solutions that are lying in the Pareto optimal front, they will not dominate each other. Okay. So basically, the MoEA techniques are classified into two categories. These are a priori approach and a posteriori approach. Again, in a priori approach, you have two categories, aggregation ordering and aggregation scalarization. Okay. So scalarization means, ordering means putting it in order. Scalarization means converting the multi-objective function to a single objective function. That is called a scalarization. Okay. And in posteriori approach, we have non-Pareto based approaches and also Pareto based approaches. So these are the way we different type of algorithms which we have. So as we have already discussed, a priori technique, it needs some prior knowledge to identify the optimal solution. Okay. Whereas a posteriori technique,
it looks for a Pareto optimal solution. That is, it will not give single solution, it will give a Pareto optimal front. The output for a posteriori technique will be a Pareto optimal front. That is the set of optimal solutions that are lying in the Pareto optimal front. So that will be the output. Okay, these solutions will be non-dominating solutions. So whatever we have discussed here in this slide, this is one way of classification, but the same can be represented in some other way. Instead of representing here, it is represented as the different way of classifying MOEA technique as a priori and a posteriori. Instead, all these algorithms put together can be classified under two categories. One is Pareto based, okay, and the other one is non-Pareto based. Okay, so like this also you can categorize. I mean, these entire things can be classified into some other two categories. These are Pareto based and non-Pareto based. So if you classify like this, only these four algorithms will be under Pareto based. Remaining all will be under non-Pareto based techniques. Okay. So even these three are under non-Pareto based techniques. So there is a classification here like that, and we are going to discuss only these algorithms. Okay. So we are going to discuss only these algorithms. So under a priori, we will be discussing these two techniques, lexicographic and SOEA, simple weighted approach. And in a posteriori, we will be discussing criteria selection, which is otherwise called as VEGA, that is a vector, E stands for evolutionary genetic algorithm, okay, vector based evolutionary genetic algorithm. And these are some of the Pareto based approaches which comes under posteriori approach. Okay. MOGA, NPGA, NSGA and NSGA2. Rank based, rank plus niche based, non-dominated sorting based approach and elitist non-dominated sorting based approach. Okay. So totally here I think some 7 algorithms are there. So we will be discussing only these 7 algorithms, right? So this is one way of representing, but they can also be represented as Pareto based and non-Pareto based. So how could you, so say for example, this here, how many algorithms are there? 1, 2, 3, 7 algorithms are there. If I want to classify these 7 algorithms as Pareto based and non-Pareto based, then which are the algorithms which will come under non-Pareto based? Question is clear. Here these algorithms are classified as a priori and a posteriori, but instead of this, say we want to classify these as non-Pareto based and Pareto based. Okay. So if you classify like that, then which are the algorithms which will come under non-Pareto based? Yeah. Hmm. Yes, these three will come under non-Pareto based, right? Remaining these four will come under Pareto based solutions, right? Okay, approach, right? Okay, so this is another way of classifying. So this slide and this slide are same. Only thing, the way of categorization is different. Okay, there in the previous slide it is categorized as a priori and a posteriori approach. Here it is classified as non-Pareto based and Pareto based approach. So here you can see that, as Akira said, these three are under non-Pareto based, remaining four are under Pareto based. Okay, fine. So we'll discuss these algorithms one by one. So first we'll be discussing lexicographic ordering. So first we'll be discussing non-Pareto based approaches. So these three are non-Pareto based: lexicographic, SOEA and criterion selection. So first let us see these three algorithms. So first is lexicographic ordering. So it is based on this paper published by M.P. Foreman in a conference in 1985. Okay. So lexicographic ordering method. So this is how any multi-objective problem is defined. it will have multiple objective function. So the function f is equal to f1, f2 up to fk. So there are many objective functions, and each of the objective function will have some condition. Okay, so f1 will have some constraint, f2 will have some constraint, so on and so forth. Every objective function will have its own constraint. Okay. Here, what is our main purpose is the objectives are ranked in the order of their importance. Who will do this? This will be done by the programmer. These objective functions should be ranked in the order of their importance. Okay. So suppose the objectives are arranged in the following order. F is equal to F1, less than F2, less than F3, so on and so forth, less than Fk. So what does it mean? So here when I say Fi less than Fj, it means that Fi is of higher importance than Fj. Okay, when you say Fi is less than Fj, which means that Fi is higher importance than Fj. Okay, so based on that, this ordering is done. So in case of lexicographic ordering, the first step is to do this ordering correctly. Right? So this is a very crucial step. After doing the ordering, what we have to do is, we have to find an optimal solution. We have to find an optimal solution x dash star by minimizing each of the objective function. So how that will be done in the sense, so there are many objective function f1 to fk. So the algorithm, what it says in the sense, first you take only one objective function f1 alone, don't take all the function, just take only one function f1 of x, but take the condition, subject to the condition is there, no? For every objective function there is a condition, take that condition. So whatever the condition, all the conditions corresponding to f1, that condition also you have to take, okay, and solve f1 and try to solve the only this objective function alone, as if it is a single objective function problem. Solve this alone, okay, that is solve the problem only for this function, only for the function f1. So when you solve the problem for the function f1, you will get a solution, optimal solution. So let us consider that solution as f1 star. So you will get an optimal solution f1 star for some value of x. So let us assume that value of x as x1 star dash. Okay, that is what this states. Okay, so solve the problem using only one function f1, one objective function f1, and find the optimal solution, let it be f1 star. So you might have found the optimal solution f1 star for a particular input x, right? So what is that, whatever that input for which you get the optimal solution, let us assume that as x1 star dash. Okay, x1 star dash. Okay, so like that you solve for every function. So first you have solved the problem using objective function 1. Similarly, solve the same problem using objective function 2. But another important thing is, when you solve the problem for the objective function 2, you have to use two conditions, two constraints. One is the original constraint which is available for the objective function 2, which is gj of x. Another constraint is this, whatever the output which come out of the previous objective function. So the previous objective function that was solved is what? F1. So that constraint also here you should add. So with gj of x, we are adding one more constraint, which is f1 of x equal to f1 dash, f1 star. Because already this was solved. The problem is solved using function f1. Okay. So these two will be added. Now again solve the problem using only the objective function f2. And whatever the solution you got, let it be f2 star. And this solution you might have obtained for some value of x. Let us call that value of x as x2 star dash. Okay, x2 star dash. So in each iteration, we find one value of x for which the particular objective function is performing or giving an optimal solution. And the solution which we obtained in each round is called as f1 star, f2 star, f3 star, so on and so forth. Okay, like that you continue. So
Similarly, at the last round, what you do? At the last round, we solve the problem for fk. Okay, using the objective function fk, and the result obtained will be fk star. And this time you might have got the better result for some value x. Let us call that as xk star dash. Okay, and this time how many constraints will be there? The original constraints, the constraint from f1, f2, f3 up to fk minus 1. Okay, so this last solution, whatever you get, fk star, whatever the last solution you get, that will be considered as the desired solution. Okay, the solution obtained at the end is xk star. So for this particular x, you got this optimal solution fk star. So whatever the for which value of x you got the optimal solution at the last round, okay, that is xk star, that will be taken as the desired solution. Okay, so this will be considered as that. So xk star will be considered as x star dash. So this is how this technique works. So to summarize what it does, in the sense, we have multiple objective function. All these objective functions, first it should be ordered. It should be ordered such a way that f1 less than f2 less than f3 less than f4, so on and so forth up to fk. So where fi less than fj, which means that fi is of higher importance than fj. Then solve the problem individually for each of the objective function. Solve the problem using objective function 1 and find the optimal solution, let it be f1 star. So when you solve for f1, we'll have only one constraint. I mean, whatever the given constraints, that alone will be there. Again, solve the problem for f2. At that time, apart from the original constraints, the constraint or the solution from the previous objective function should be included, which is f1 of x is equal to f1 star. With that constraint included, solve the problem for f2 and find the optimal solution. So on and so forth, like that, to do up to last function fk. So finally, for the last function fk, when you solve it, you will get an optimal solution. Okay, so you will get an optimal solution for some value of x. So that value of x, xk star, so whatever the value of x for which in the last round you get the optimal solution, that will be treated as x star, that is the optimal solution. Okay, so this is how this lexical ordering method is followed. The drawback or the remarks on this method is deciding the priority is challenging. Priority means this ranking. How will you know the ranking? So it's not an easy task to do that. Okay, and there are different variations of these lexicographic techniques are available. The variations are like, instead of ranking, you follow some random selection. So because this ranking is not an easy thing, it needs lot of experience, or you should have lot of domain knowledge. So instead of going for ranking, you randomly out of k, you decide, you pick up randomly which should be first, which should be second, and so on and so forth. Otherwise, what it says, in the sense, a naive approach is to try with k factorial number of orderings of k objective function and select the best observed result. So this is possible if the number of objective function is less. So k represents the number of objective function. So if there is only 3 objective functions, say, for simplicity, let us assume k is 3. There is only 3 objective functions, f1, f2 and f3. Now, what are the different combinations of trying this, that is 3 factorial, which is 3 into 2, 6, 6 into 1, 6. So there is only 6 combinations. Either f1, f2, f3, f3, f2, f1, f2, f1, f3, f2, f3, f1. Like that, there are only 6 combinations. So this technique, what it says, in the sense, try all the 6 combinations. Try all the 6 combinations and see for which one you are getting the better result, and take that as the result. But this is okay if k value is small. If k value is very high, like 100, then k factorial will be very high. Then you cannot do that many times. Okay. So these are the drawback of this technique. And this technique will produce a single solution. Finally, it will give a single solution, x star dash.
it won't give a Pareto optimal solution. Obviously, you know that this algorithm is not under Pareto optimal category. It is in non-Pareto optimal category. Okay. So this is how this technique works. So could someone summarize how lexicographic ordering works? Yeah, okay. Now before that, what should be done? Before that, ordering. First it should be ordered, right? How it should be ordered? First, all the objective functions should be ordered. F1, F2, F1 less than F2, F2 less than F3, like that, up to less than Fk. Fi less than Fj implies what? Fi is more important than Fj. It is more important than Fj. First, this ordering should be done. Once the ordering is done, then what should we do? Yeah. For the first objective function, what will be the constraint? Yeah. For the second objective function, when you solve the problem for second objective function, what will be the constraint? Previous result and the original constraint. When you solve for the kth time, kth objective function, what will be the constraints? K minus 1 previous results. Yeah. What will be the solution? Final solution will be? Yeah. Single solution, which is a solution which is coming from which objective? Yeah, that is fine. But that solution is produced by which objective function? Finally, whatever the solution we are assuming a solution, that will be the solution of which objective function? The solution of the last objective function, right? Fk. So Fk, the function Fk is going to give an optimal solution for some x, okay? So that x, that will be the optimal solution. That will be treated as the optimal solution. Okay. So this is how this lexico ordering technique works. And what are the drawbacks with this technique? Okay. What else? So, what are the other way of implementing this? We can also try for, instead of giving any specific order, we can try a random order, or we can try all possible combinations, and then we can find out what is the best solution. But that is fine if the number of objective functions are minimal. If there are many objective functions, then you cannot do that. Fine. So that's it about lexicographic ordering technique. So next we'll be discussing about another approach for non-Pareto based algorithm, which is single objective evolutionary algorithm. This is otherwise also called as weighted sum approach. This technique is also called as weighted sum approach. So this is also a non-Pareto based approach.
So this is also a non-Pareto based approach, and also it comes under the class of a priori technique.
I don't know, some problem.
Right. So it is otherwise called as weighted sum approach. So it is also a naive approach to solve MOOP. Naive means very basic approach. It's not an advanced technique.
Okay.
So this method, what it says in the sense, for every objective function we have to identify a weight. So if there are k objective functions, then for each of the k objective function you have to identify the weight. So if there is f1, f2 up to fk, then for each of the objective function you have to identify the weight. Like for f1 maybe w1, f2 w2, f3 w3, so on and so forth. For fn or fk, so here they are calling n objective function. So if there are n objective function, then you have to identify n weights. Okay, and then convert the multi-objective optimization problem into a single objective optimization problem, something like this. So finally it will be converted into a single objective optimization problem where fitness will be calculated like this. Fitness is equal to sigma I is equal to 1 to n wi into fi of x. Okay. So generally when you add these weights, these weights should be sum up to 1. So it is usually assumed like that. It is usually assumed that all these weights will be summed up to 1. Okay. So this type of optimization approach is called as SOIEA, or is otherwise called as a weighted sum approach, as we are including some weight and we are multiplying with each of the objective function. So this is a very simple algorithm. The result of solving an optimization problem can vary significantly as the weight varies. So it entirely depends on the weight. So how the solution will work, in the sense it totally depends on the weight. Like how in the previous algorithm, lexicographic approach, deciding the order is a challenging part. Similarly, in this approach, deciding the weight is a challenging thing. Okay. So for different WIs, it will provide different weight. Since very little is usually known about how to choose this coefficient means weight, it may result in local optima. Mostly, the solution which is produced by this algorithm will result in local optima, because we don't know how to choose these weights. Right? There is no standard technique to choose the weight. So this algorithm, basically it will give a line as an output, one line. That is, you can consider any solution that is lying on the line. And if you change the weight, then the shape of the line will change, right? The lines, how it, the line will rotate. If you change the weight, the line will rotate. For example, for one set of weights, if the line is like this, then for another set of weight, the line will become like this. Okay. So like that, it will, what do you call? It will, change its shape. It will, the way in which it gets oriented, it will differ depending on the weight. So we have to identify the correct weight so that you can identify the correct solution. So to improve this approach, it is not only enough to include weight. So it is advised to include another constant called CI. Again, this CI will not be same for each FI. It will be different for different FI. So it is advisable to add a constant called CI with each FI, so that the solution will be more optimal. Okay. The reason for this is, for example, here we are using many objective functions, F1, F2, up to Fn, because it is a multi-objective problem. That we know, but different objective problem may be on different units. Okay, for example, objective function 1, F1, the unit of F1 may be in terms of meter, whereas the unit of F2 may be, its unit may be something different. Okay, so F1, if it is in meters, then all should be in meters only. Are you getting the point? Say if F1 is in different unit, F2 is in different unit, F3 is in different unit,
If each one of them is in different unit, then their W1, then their weights also will be appropriately different. Okay, that is it. It doesn't make sense. For example, F1 is in terms of kilometers, and F2 is in terms of millimeters. Then there is a huge difference. Okay, so their weight will also appropriately scale down. To avoid that issue, we are including this CI. Okay, so CI is something like you are bringing everything to common level. So if one parameter is in millimeter, another parameter is in centimeter, then whatever is in millimeter you are converting to centimeter, something like that. Okay, so that is what this CI does, right? Where CI is a constant multiplier that scales the objective properly. So it scales the objective in a proper domain. Okay, so the weight coefficient do not proportionately reflects the relative importance of the objective, but are only factors. This method depends only on weights WI, but also not only depends on the weight, but also on the units in which the functions are expressed. So these functions, different function may get expressed in different units. In that case, then the weight will become, then the weight will not behave in the way in which we are expecting it to behave. So that we are including this CI, right? Okay. So another drawback with this technique is, as long as the output is a straight line, it will give all the outputs available in that line. But if the objective function is of this shape, if it is of this particular shape, then this algorithm cannot give an correct solution. It will give a line only. Its output will be always a line, something like this. So in that case, it cannot draw a curve line. Its line will be straight lines only. So it can draw only a straight line like this. So only these point, whatever the points of this line touching here, only these points it can give us output, even if you identify the correct weight. Okay. So this is how this technique works. So this is called as weighted sum approach, or SOEA, single objective evolutionary algorithm. Why we call it a single objective evolutionary algorithm? Because here we convert the multi-objective problem into a single objective problem. So could someone summarize this second approach? What is SOEA? Weighted sum method. How we convert? Okay. So the fitness is calculated like what? Fitness is equal to what? WIFI. Later we add that XI. Why we add this XI? What if we don't add FI? The original proposal is without XI. Here there is no XI, right? Later we add XI. Why we are adding XI? Because FI may be in different unit. Okay. There are different FIs, right? F1 is there, F2 is there, F3 is there. So F1 may be in one unit, F2 may be in another unit, F3 may be in some other unit. To scale it properly, we are adding the XI. What's the drawback of this approach? What else? If the objective function is not like a box or any, if the objective function is something like a box or anything, then it will give a good solution. It may give a good solution if the weights are identified correctly. But if the objective function is in curve shape, then it cannot identify correctly, because it will always give a line as output. So in this case, the output should be this curve, but it cannot do, because this algorithm itself, it will give some straight line as output. So this is about the second approach, which is SOEA, single objective evolutionary algorithm. What about others? I want everybody to answer. The next technique we'll be discussing is vector evaluated genetic algorithm, which is VAGA, VEGA. It is also called as VEGA. So this algorithm is proposed by David Shafter in 1985. It is considered as the first implementation of MOEA. And it is a posteriori technique. It is a posteriori technique, but it is not Pareto based solution. It will also give non-Pareto based solution, but it is a posteriori technique. It is an extension of simple genetic algorithm. It differs from simple genetic algorithm in way in which the selection operation is done. So let us try to understand how it works. So what we do here in the sense, so here we have multiple objective functions. Say let us assume we have k objective functions. I don't know why this issue is happening. Let me. Okay, so say assume there are k objective functions f1, f2 up to fk. We will identify some set of suboptimal solutions. How many suboptimal solutions we will identify in the sense subpopulation? How many subpopulation we will identify in the sense k subpopulation we will identify? As there are k objective function, we will identify k subpopulation. And what will be the size of each of the subpopulation in the sense? The size of each of the subpopulation will be m by k. So we want to identify k subpopulation such that the size of each of the subpopulation will be m by k, where m is the size of the mating pool. And m will be less than or equal to n. Okay. So for example, originally if you have 100 solutions, okay, and say for mating pool, if you want to identify 20 solutions, so in that case, m is equal to 20. Okay. And if you want to make it as, so, 10 subpopulation, then k will be 10. So m is 20, k is 10 means 20 by 10. So you will make it as two subpopulation, right? So each subpopulation will have 50-50, okay, something like that, right? So we'll make k subpopulation where the size of each subpopulation will be of m by k, where m is the size of the mating pool, and n is the size of the population. Okay. These subpopulations are then shuffled together. First, we make it into what you call k. We create k subpopulations. After creating k subpopulations, where each subpopulation contains m by k solutions, where each subpopulation contains m by k solutions, right? Then what we do is then we do shuffling. These subpopulations are shuffled together to obtain a new ordering of individuals. Then we apply the standard GA operation to perform the reproduction. Okay, and then we keep repeating the above steps until the convergence condition is reached. So whatever we have discussed here, it is explained in this here diagrammatically. So initially, let us assume this is the initial population. The initial population contains n solutions, 1 to n. Now from this n solution, we want to differentiate, we want to make categorization, like we want to make k categories. We want to make k categories where k is the number of objective function, where each of the or you can call it as k category or k subpopulation. So this is subpopulation 1, subpopulation 2, like that up to k subpopulation we want to make, where each of the subpopulation will contains m by k individuals, where m is the size of the mating pool. Okay, where m is the size of the mating pool, so each will have that many individuals. Okay, so like that we categorize first. After categorizing, then what we do, then we perform shuffling. So this is the result after shuffling. So first we categorize subpopulation 1, subpopulation 2, like that we categorize into k. Then shuffling is done. So totally it is reordered, and again there are n individuals. Okay. Then from this n individual, some selection operation is performed, and then crossover is done, and the new population is generated. This process continues until you find an optimal solution. So we are discussing at overall how it works. Still we are not discussing in detail, so we'll discuss. So Vega consists of following three major steps. First it needs to create k subpopulation such that the size of each subpopulation will be m by k, where m is the size of the mating pool. Okay, then it shuffles the subpopulation, and then it reproduces offspring for the next generation. So these are the three important steps. Okay. So suppose the MOOC problem is defined like this, with k objective function, such a way that f is equal to f1, f2, up to fk. And let us assume the initial population size is n. And initially the population contains n individuals. That is, n individuals means each individual is a solution, i1, i2, up to in. And let us assume that we want to create a mating pool of size m, where m is less than or equal to n. M should be less than or equal to m. M should be less than or equal to n. Then we want to create mating pool of size mating pool of size m. So how do we create the mating pool of size m? Generate ith subpopulation of size m by k. Generate ith subpopulation of size m by k, where I is equal to 1 to k. That is, we are going to create k subpopulation. First subpopulation will be of size m by k. Second subpopulation will be of size m by k. Like that we create k different subpopulation. Okay. To do this, follow the proportional selection strategy, either roulette wheel selection or any one technique previously whatever we have discussed. Right? So by following this, we are creating different subpopulation. This is subpopulation 1, subpopulation 2, like that up to subpopulation k. Here one important thing you should understand. Subpopulation 1 is created, how we are creating this subpopulation 1? Subpopulation 1 is created with respect to the function f1. So there are many objective functions, right? f1, f2, like that we have multiple objective function. So So the subpopulation 1 is created based on the objective function F1. For the objective function F1, whichever the individuals are giving better results, they will be coming under subpopulation 1. And similarly, for the objective function F2, whichever the solution are giving better result, they will be coming under subpopulation 2, so on and so forth. And for the objective function F3, whoever is giving better result will be coming under F3. Like that, it goes on. Okay. And for the objective function Fk, whoever giving better result, they will be coming in the subpopulation Fk. Right. So totally there are k subpopulation created. The number of solutions in each of these will be equal to m by k. Then we do shuffling. How we perform shuffling? Say for example, if you want to shuffle between first subpopulation and second subpopulation, then we select a random number. Then we create two random numbers. Say here we want to shuffle between two subpopulations. Say this is one subpopulation, say this is some first subpopulation or second, or say this is fifth subpopulation. Say this is second and this is fifth. Between second and fifth we want to perform shuffling. Then we create two random numbers which we call it as I and J. So the ith individual from this subpopulation will be swapped with the jth individual from this subpopulation, because each subpopulation contains what? Many individuals, right? Each subpopulation contains many individuals, right? So we generate some random number I and J. So depending on the random number I and J, we perform shuffling. Okay. So after shuffling, we go for reproduction. So perform reproduction to produce the next generation of population of size n. So this is done either by using crossover or mutation or inversion, any of the technique. Okay. So this is how basically this Weigaud technique works. See here you can see here originally there are n individuals are there. But here there is only m individuals. Create a mating pool of size m. Okay, so how we are creating this size m? Because m is nothing but the size of the mating pool. Okay, so we, for example, if you want to say the current population size is 100, say let us assume a bigger number. Say the current population size is 1000. Okay, say m is 100. We want to identify 100 individuals for the mating pool. Okay, say k is 10. Okay, say k is 10, which represents what? K represents the number of objective function. Say we have 10 objective function. Okay, so then we are going to create k subpopulation such that each will have m by k elements. Okay, so m is 100. 100 by 10 is what? 10. Okay, so each will have 10 elements. This will have 10 element, this will have 10 element, like that each of this k thing will have 10 elements. So totally it is m. Are you getting? So totally from this we are not selecting everybody, we are selecting only the top individuals. For example, the subpopulation 1, it holds only those individuals or solution which gives better result for F1. Okay, subpopulation 2, it contains only top 10 individuals which gives better result for F2. Like that, for each of the function we are taking only the top 10, right? So finally we got only m individuals. Even though the size is 1000, we got only 100, right? And out of this 100, again we perform shuffling. Again we perform, so we got 100, and then we select some random number I and J, and then I and J were shuffled. Okay, and then we go for crossover, right? So this is how this technique works. So could someone summarize how VEGA works? Miss? This subpopulation division, how it happens? How the subpopulation division is happening? No, I'm not asking that. Each subpopulation will have how many entries? M by K. What is M? What is K? K is the number. Objective function. Number of subpopulation is correct, but K is also what? Number of objective function. Okay, this K comes from number of objective functions. And what is N? What is N? Okay, assume that N is equal to 2000 and K is equal to 20. Okay, say M is equal to 200. Then what will be the size of each subpopulation? Is the question? Yeah. Okay. Assume N is 200. N is 2000. Assume N is 2000. Assume K is. Okay, and assume M should be 200. Then what will be the size of each individual subpopulation? What about others? Are you listening? Yeah, could you answer? It's a straightforward question, right? So I'm saying N is 2000. M should be say 200. Say K is 20. Then what will be the size of each individual subpopulation? Which is 10, right? 20. 10. Yeah, 10. Okay. So 10. So like that, there will be 20 subpopulation. So 20 into 10 will be 200. Are you getting? So how M becomes, so here from N it is reduced to M. Here the size of the population is N. Here it becomes M. How it is reduced? Because here we are selecting only M by K individuals. Okay, we are selecting only M by K individuals. That is, for example, if that's what I said, if N is equal to 2000, I'll take the notepad. I'm unable to write here. So if n is equal to 2000, initially n is 2000, say we want m to be 200, that is the mating pool size we want to be 200, and say the number of objective function f1, f2 up to fk, that is k is equal to 20, then we will make k subpopulation, that is 20 subpopulations we will make. We will create 20 subpopulation such that each subpopulation will have how many entries? M by k entries, which is nothing but what? 200 by 20, which is 10. Okay. So 200 by 10 is in every subpopulation. That is, first subpopulation contains 20 entries. Second subpopulation contains 20 entries. Like that, how many subpopulation we have? So each subpopulation contains 20. It goes on like that. We have 20 subpopulation. So 20th subpopulation also have 20. So if you sum up all these things, what will you get? 10. Each subpopulation contains 10. Sorry, not 20. Right. So if you add all these things, what will you get? If you add all these 10, 20 times 10, what is the result? 200. Okay. So what should be m? M should be 200, right? M should be 200. Our m is what? The size of mating pool. That is how it is reduced. The size of n is reduced to m. Okay. And another question. How we are identifying? Okay, this is mathematical part is fine. That is, we are going to identify m by k individuals for each objective function. Okay, now, so in this case, say m by k is 10 individuals. For each objective function, we are going to identify 10 individuals. So the first 10 individuals, how we are going to identify? They are with respect to which objective function? First 10 individuals are identified with respect to which objective function? F1. Okay. That is, ignore all the objective function. Ignore all the objective function and solve the problem for first objective function. And see that out of this original population size is 2000. Out of this 2000 population, who is giving better result? So there are 2000 solutions available, but solve F1 using all 2000 solutions. Solve F1 using all n individuals. Okay, n individuals. Then out of that, you pick up first top 10 individuals. That is, you identify the top 10 individuals who are doing better for F1. Identify top 10. Okay, or top m by k individuals. Right. So that is how we identify the subpopulation for the first subpopulation. Similarly, how will you identify the second subpopulation? Solve for F2 using all n individuals, and then you have to identify what? Yeah, again top 10, which is nothing but top 10 is nothing but m by k individuals. Okay, so like that we do, so on and so forth. You continue this process. Similarly, identify a top m by k individuals for F2, F3, and at last we have to do for, yeah, which is Fk. So in this case, k is equal to 20 using all n individuals. Okay, and then you identify again a top 10 solution, which is nothing but m by k solutions. Okay. So after doing this, we got how many solutions? 200 solutions. Then what should we do? Then we should go shuffle. Okay. So previously I said there is here now there is only 200 individuals. So now there is nothing like any subpopulation. There is no subpopulation. Previously I said subpopulation. There is no subpopulation. Out of these 200, you just create two numbers. So there are m. So So m is 1, 1, m is 200. So 1 to 200, you create a random number. So 1 to 200, you create two random numbers. One we call it as I, another one we call it as J. For example, if I is 40 and J is 70, then what should we do? Swap it, shuffle. So shuffle these two solutions. That is, the solution 40 will go to 70th position, and solution 70 will come to 40th position. Okay, like that you can swap for any number of times. There is no restriction. That will be desired by the programmer. Say, assume that once again you want to swap. Assume now I is equal to 180. Say J is equal to 86. Now which one should be swapped? Now how this swapping will be done? Like that. Depending on the problem requirement, we do swapping. Okay. After swapping, then we go for reproduction. Right. So this is how this algorithm works. So the advantage is, so Vega can be implemented in the same framework as SGA, that is simple GA, with a small modification for selection procedure. That is the advantage. That is, you can use the existing framework, you need not build a new framework. Okay. So it can be viewed something like this. Like how we said that the previous algorithm, the weighted sum approach, we can say that it is nothing but f of x is equal to summation of, that is sigma, okay, sigma is not there, so I am writing summation of wi into fi, of course into ci is there, but this is the basic version. Okay, like this we can represent. So the final output there is a scalar, so that is called as it provides a scalar output. Similarly, Vega can be viewed as a vector approach. So Vega can be viewed something like this. It can be viewed as optimizing F1, F2, Fk simultaneously. That is what we are doing, is it is something like this. F of x is equal to E1 cap F1x plus E2 cap F2x, so on and so forth, Ek Fkx. So basically it is very similar to the previous one. Instead of W1, Wi, here we are using E1 cap. Okay. But actually there is a difference. This Wi represents weight. In case of weighted sum, the Wi thing, it represents weight. Okay. But here this Ei cap. Okay. I'll write like this. This Ei cap, it represents a vector. It's not a scalar quantity. These weights are scalar. In case of weighted sum method, these weights are scalar. These individual weights are scalar. Scalar means it is some value, some one value, 1, 2, 3 or 100 or whatever it may be. But here this Ei cap is a vector. So vector is nothing but an array. It's not one value, right? So normally we represent a vector something like this. Say there is a vector 1, 2, 89. This is one vector. So it is a vector. So this vector is multiplied with every function. Okay. So because of that only it is called as a vectored approach, Ei cap is the ith vector. Okay. So whatever the operation we are doing, whatever the algorithm we discussed, that can be mathematically represented like this. Represented like this. Why we are saying vector? Any answer? Why we are saying is a vector? You have any answer? What is this m by k? What is m by k? What is m by k? In Vega, what is m by k? Subpopulation size. So what is m by k for the first function? Or I'll put it in another way. See, in the previous case, for each of the subpopulation, what is the size of each of the subpopulation? In this example. N. Okay, that is for function 1, that is for objective function 1, we are identifying 10 individuals. Okay. For objective function 2, we are identifying 10 individuals. For every objective function, you are going to identify m by k individuals. So you are not identifying one individual, you are identifying m by k individual. So this m by k is a vector. Are you getting? So we are not identifying one solution for each function, we are identifying m by k solution. So that vector thing comes here. That is, for each objective function, we are identifying some top x individuals. For first function, some top x individual. For second function, some top x individuals. For third function, some top x individuals. Okay, so it is a vector. So it's not one individual. X individuals we are identifying, and then we are performing some operation. So that this vector part comes here. So if you are not understanding this, just understand that that is a scalar optimization thing. This is a vector optimization. I'm trying to justify how this vector comes. Okay. So the disadvantage of this approach is the solution generated by Vega are generally locally non-dominated solution. But that doesn't mean that globally also they may not be dominated. Okay. This is because their non-dominance are limited to current population only. What does it mean? Say for example, here in each round that is the subpopulation you consider. The subpopulation created for the using function F1. That is some 10 individuals we created. Okay, that is some 10 individuals we have created. Now you can say that these 10 individuals we are putting all these 10 individuals in the same bracket, even though they may differ in the objective function. I mean, even though they may differ in the fitness score. But now we are saying that everybody are equal because we consider all the 10 now. So it means that all are equal. So it means they are non-dominating. Are you getting? Say for example, somebody who got say 93 in data structures, okay. Somebody got 78 in data structures, okay. But finally, during grading, it was, so there is a huge gap, right? 98 to 78, there is a big gap, okay. There are many students in between, okay. But say that finally during grading, it was decided that all students greater than 78 will get A grade. Now finally they all are in the same bracket, okay. So could you say that after deciding the grades, after making that 78 also in the A grade range, now can you say that here one individual is dominating another individual? Yes or no? In this set, is any individual is dominating another? Could you answer the question? Is the question is clear or not? Is the question is clear? You want me to repeat? Okay. Say for example, a particular course, the students' marks are ranging from say 1 to 100, 1 to say 92. Say 92 is the top mark. Okay. Say grading is not done. Okay. Grading is not done. Say for example, there is a student with mark 78. There is a student with mark 88. There is a student with mark 89. Okay. Assume grading is not done. There is a student with 23. There is a student with 56. Now, what I am asking is 92 is dominating 89? Yes or no? Is 89 is dominating 88? Is 88 is dominating 78? Is 78 is dominating 56?
Okay, so every bigger number is dominating every other number, right? Say grading is done. Later at some point, grading is done. Say anybody greater than 78 is considered as A grade. Okay. So now these people are in the bracket A grade. Okay. After grading, now can I say that 92 is dominating 78? No, with respect to grade. Respect to grade, are they dominating? Is 92 is dominating 78? See only the grade, they are equal. They are not dominating, they are under non-dominating set. So they are not going to influence your CGPA. Are you getting my point? Whether the question is whether you are A grade or not, it is not whether you are 92 or 78. Okay. It is going to influence your CGPA in the same way. So they are in the non-dominating set. Okay. So the same thing here also. Initially we have individuals with different fitness score, everything. Now you are solving the problem using one function F1. Using one function F1, you have solved the problem. And you have identified the individuals with top 10 fitness score for F1. Okay. So that may include some individual. Individual 1, individual 2, individual 3. Like that you identified some 10 individuals. These 10 individuals are the top 10 individuals with respect to the function F1. Okay. Again, explicitly if you see, maybe individual 1 may have better score, fitness score. Individual 2 may have comparatively less fitness score. Individual 3 may have comparatively less fitness score. Okay. But now you have categorized. Already you have categorized that all these guys are in the same bracket. Okay. So now are they dominating each other? Is anybody dominating anybody else in this group? No. But before categorizing, are they dominating? Yes. Okay. So that is what this statement is saying. The solution generated by Vega are locally non-dominated, but not necessarily globally dominated. This is because their non-dominance are limited only to the current population. Okay. So this is local. Why this is local? Because it is only with respect to F1. With respect to F2, will it be the same individual will come for F2 also? Will it be the maybe some different individual, right? Yeah, maybe some individual may repeat, but will it be the same sequence? No, not sequence. There is no sequence here. Will it be the same? All these individuals will come as it is. No. Some repetition may be there. Okay. Maybe here I-13 will be there. I-23 will be there. Maybe I-10 may come or may not come, like that. Okay. So it means what? Each set is a local set, because each set is for one function. Okay. So in this set, nobody is dominating anybody. In this set also nobody is dominating anybody. Okay. So that doesn't mean that in some set there is someone who is globally dominating. We cannot guarantee that. That's what this statement says. The solution generated are locally not dominated, but not necessarily they are globally dominated. There is no guarantee that there is any global domination. Okay. This is because the non-dominance are limited to the current population. Their non-dominance is limited only to the current population or the current subpopulation group. Okay. And it creates a problem called speciation. It involves the evolution of species within the population, which excels on different objectives. This is so because Vega selects individuals who excel in one objective without looking at others. Okay. So this actually the way of working of Vega is what? It identifies individual who is good at one objective function first, top 10 individuals. Then who is good at some other objective function, so that is some other set. Then who is good at third objective function, that is some other set. Okay. So like that, for individual set it identifies separately. So this problem is called as speciation. That is, it involves the evolution of species within the population. This is so because it selects individuals who excel in one objective without looking at others. So it is not doing a holistic approach. It is not, as a whole, it is not seeing who is performing well in all the objective function. One by one objective function it is doing. So that problem is called as a speciation problem. Okay, right? It is something like you have 6 courses. So the best way to look at it may be looking at your average, like how is your average is. But rather, if I see like how you are performing well in one course, then in another course, then in another course, like that, if I am making some calculation, then finally I cannot say how much effective that technique is. Okay, so basically Vagoff faces a problem. This problem is called as middling performance. This problem is called as middling performance. That is this Vagoff leads to a middling performance problem. That is, it will identify an individual with acceptable performance, perhaps above average, but not an outstanding individual. This is the drawback with Vagoff. That is, you cannot say that it will produce the best output. It may produce an output which is better than the average output. It will produce an output which is better than the average output, but it will not produce an outstanding output because of the way in which it is working. Because it solves each individual function separately and agrees to reach the best solution, and so on and so forth, right? Okay, so that's it about Vagoff. So could someone say what are the drawbacks of Vagoff techniques? Non-dominant, locally it is non-dominant. What is meant by locally non-dominant means what? The solution in each subpopulation will not dominate each other. Okay, they are considered as equal. Because we are solving for one objective function and then we are picking the best individual for that objective function. So they are not dominating. So and also they are globally also they need not be dominated. So we cannot say that some solution is globally dominating some other solution. Okay. Somebody's mic is on, please switch off. And another drawback is it creates something called, it leads to a problem called speciation. That is it actually works based on a single objective function and it ignores other objective function. So for a given objective function, it checks who is a better individual. And as a result, it may lead to a problem called middling performance. That is, as a whole, it will identify an individual with acceptable performance who is better than average but not an outstanding individual. Okay. Fine, let us stop here for today's session.